Now, I come to the second category of taxpayers who are having turnover which is more than 1.5 but less than 5 crores, right? Or up to 5 crores. Now, if I am in the second category, again, if I have filed it within the due date, no worries. I was able to file my February return within time, no worries. Or if I'm not able to file my returns from February to April 2020 within the due dates that are stipulated, the due date or the revised timeline by which you are required to comply as the second category of taxpayer is again staggered for the period February 2020 and for the return for the period March 2020. In both these cases, you are allowed to file your 3B by 29th of June 2020. April 2020, that would have been ideally due in May 2020, has been extended up to 30th of June 2020. Now, when I use the word extended, the due date is not extended, as I have been again and again emphasizing. Only the date for compliance and getting conditional benefit is extended. So if I'm filing the returns for the month of February and March by 29th of June and filing my 3B for the month of April by 30th of June, then in that case, I will not have to pay any late fees. And not only that, I would not also have to pay any kind of interest, right? So up to 29th of 2020, for taxpayers between 1.5 crores to 5 crores, no interest, no penalty for 3B due for the months of February, March and April. However, if I have not filed my returns by those dates, if I have not filed my 3B for these 3 months by these dates that I just mentioned, then I would be levied full interest and full penalty as if I would have defaulted under the normal law, right? So 18% interest, late fees of 50 rupees or whatever. If it's a nil return, then late fees of nil return. Thereby, I would have to pay the entire penalty right from day one, that is 20th, 22nd, whatever is the due date, depending on your state and obviously the turnover. The third category of taxpayers are those who are very small taxpayers below 1.5 crore of turnover. Again, for them, the due date to comply and take benefit of this notification are as follows. For February and March, you can comply by 30th of June. For February, you can comply by 30th of June. For March, you can comply by 3rd of July. And April, you can take benefit of this notification right up to 6th of July 2020. If you are able to comply within these dates, you get the benefit of complete waiver from interest and penalty. If you are filing after these dates, then as has been the case, full interest and full penalty would be levied. Right? Having discussed 3B for the month of February, March and April, I now come to 3B for the month of May 2020. May 2020, again, there are categories of taxpayers. First category, if my turnover is more than 5 crores, I might be having my registration in any state. Due date to comply is extended even for May 2020 3B. And the revised due date that I have been given is 27th of June 2020, right? Next, if my turnover is up to 5 crores of turnover. Now, if my previous financial year's turnover, which is 1920, has not exceeded 5 crore, then I will have to check in which state is my registration. As has been the case until now, they have given you two staggered timelines for filing depending on the state categories. The state to which you pertain, say for example, we are having GST registrations in Maharashtra, then the due date will be 12th of July. For some other states, Jammu and Kashmir, Himachal Pradesh, Rajasthan, Delhi, all these states which are appearing on the right side of your screen, they are supposed to comply by 14th of July 2020 in respect of 3B for the month of May 2020. Right? So, by this, I think I've largely covered GSTR 1 and GSTR 3B for various months and the benefits that the government has given considering the current scenario. I have also tried to summarize this in the form of a table for ease of reference. so that you don't have to, you know, again and again go through the notifications or again and again go through those individual slides. One summarized slide is where I have tried to summarize it, where I have given you both the benefits in terms of interest and in terms of late fees. As I said, there is no due date extension. So I have not mentioned anywhere the word due date as such. First table, if you see, is for concessional rate of interest that I get to avail. The concessional rate of interest that I get to avail if I'm below 5 crores of turnover is that if I file my returns somewhere by the end of June, then I don't have to pay any interest. Practically, this means that all those businesses who have turnover of 5 crores, and when I say turnover of 5 crores, it's not per GSTIN. It is per person. It's per PAN, right? So the turnover for the entire entity is what you have to see. If it is below 5 crores, I can practically delay my tax filings of GSTR 3B, GSTR 1, and use this GST amount as my working capital. In a way, government has tried to also compensate you by giving you delayed payment of GST and giving you the working capital that might be, you know, a matter of concern in the current times. And maybe by, you know, somewhere around the, like, depending on the various due dates that have been notified for various months, all of which fall towards the end of June or later than that. Basically, up to end of June, a 5 crore entity, up to 5 crore entity can use the working capital, which ideally paid as GST without any interest. Above 5 crores, as we have already discussed, you get 15 days of interest-free capital by delaying your GST payment by up to 15 days from the due date. Beyond that, again, the government has tried to give you benefit by giving a concessional interest rate of a meager 9%, right? Up to 24th of June 2020, you can avail working capital at the rate of 9% in a way. And any returns filed thereafter would, as I said, attract normal interest, which would have been levied under the law, and thereby 18% would be the rate of interest. Coming to the next table, I have summarized various due dates. These due dates are not, as I said, the extended due dates, but the due dates to comply with and benefit under the notifications that have come out. And if I'm able to comply with these dates, then I get the waiver from interest and penalty as has been prescribed by the government. I have divided the table into two parts or three parts rather, if I would say. First is GSTR 1, second is GSTR 3B, and lastly, it is for composition taxpayers. Concentrating on the first part, which is GSTR 1, as you can see, across the board, GSTR 1 has been deferred, and the date that has now been made applicable is 30th June to take benefit of the notification. GSTR 3B, it is category-wise, as I have already discussed, three categories have been prescribed by the government. Depending on the category you fall into, you can check the month for which you are required to file 3B. For whichever return month you are filing the 3B, the date is mentioned over there. For ease of reference, I have color-coded all these cells, and I have given the color coding below the chart or the reference below for the color coding. These are the notifications that you can refer to cross-check any of the dates. Also, for May 2020, I have written the date of 3B as 12th of July for taxpayers below 5 crore, right? Please note, as I said, 12th of July is for taxpayers pertaining to one category of states or one bunch of states. The other set of states, the due date would be 14th July 2020. The asterisk has been put above the date, and the states which are required to comply have been given as a footnote who can comply by the 14th of July 2020. The third category, as I said, is the composition taxpayers. Now, if GSTR 1 and 3B have been extended, it would not be fair for the composition taxpayers to be put to hardship. Thereby, they have extended the due date for composition taxpayers as well, and they can returns by July 2020, 7th of July 2020, right? Those taxpayers who file annual GSTR4, they are required to be filing those returns by 15th of July 2020 to take benefit of those notifications, right? So again, CMP08 and GSTR4 are composition for taxpayer related I have given the due date for those as well. This is an illustration table that I have made out to help us understand that what would be the scenario as far as interest is concerned when the filing is delayed. The filing of GSTR 3B is delayed, then in that case, I would have to see whether, now I have taken this example from the perspective of a taxpayer who is above 5 crores. So I'll have to first, I'm complying within 15 days or not. If I'm not complying within the first 15 days, then in that case, I'll have to go to the next condition, right? So the first serial number is 2nd of May 2020, and we are taking a scenario where this person above 5 crores is filing GSTR 3B for the month of March 2020. So March 2020, if I would have ideally filed my GSTR 1, I would have filed it in April 2020. However, I'm now filing it in 2nd of May 2020. If I file on 2nd of May 2020, I'm delaying my filing by 10 days. If I'm filing my if I'm delaying my filing by 11 days, I'm still within the criteria of 15 days, and thereby I'm entitled to waiver of interest and penalty or other late fees. In 20th of May, if I file it on 20th of May, I would have deferred my 3B by a month, right? By 30 days, because the normal date would have been 20th of May for 5 crores and above. Now, if I've exceeded the 15-day criteria, I still have a concessional interest rate that I can avail of. That beneficial rate of 9% is what I will have to pay. Again, the 9% would be applicable from 16th day onwards, right? So from 16th day to the 30th day is the period for which I will calculate interest. This interest will be at the rate of 9%. And there would be no late fees that would be levied. Coming to the third set of example, that example takes the date of filing as 20th of June 2020. I'm still not crossing the prescribed date. I am still within the 24th of June 2020 date. I have delayed, however, my 3B by 61 days. Since tax payment has been delayed by 61 days, which is more than 15 days, being above 5 crores, I will start calculating my interest from 16th day up to 61st day. 9% is what I will pay for 46 days of the delay. So on so forth. So again, for 24th of June, again, being the last day, I can comply by taking benefit of the concessional notifications and avoid payment of interest at higher rate. However, if I delay anything beyond that, then if I'm filing on 30th of June, my delay is beyond the maximum timeline that was prescribed to take benefit, and thereby interest at the rate of 18% would be levied. This 18% would be levied right from 21st of April 2020. I hope I'm clear. Right from the date that would have been the due date had these notifications not been issued. From that day, normal interest rate that I would have paid, which is 18%, would be levied. Obviously, late fees would also be levied. Now, coming on to the second thing that I need to explain, which is of utmost importance. The second thing that is of utmost importance and that has been bothering many of us who have already gone through these notifications is Rule 36.4. Rule 36.4 comes into play whenever we are paying our taxes. The government has said that as per this rule, I cannot exceed benefit of ITC by 10% as compared to what is appearing in my 2A. So vis-a-vis my 2A, I check whatever ITC is there in my books. ITC in books cannot exceed by 10% from that appearing in 2A. Correct? Now, if that criteria is made applicable for these periods, the difficulty that was arising was from February to May, my return filing has been delayed. My GSTR 1 will be filed only at the end because GSTR 1 blanket waiver is there right up to 30th of June, be it any category of taxpayer above 5 crores or below 5 crores. However, for taxpayers above 5 crores, they are still required to file monthly 3Bs. Only benefit that has been given to them is delaying it by 15 days. So they would still like to comply and take benefit of those zero interest rate within 15 day criteria or period. Now, when they go to file their 3B, after 50 or within that 15-day period, 15-day concessional period, then in that case, they would have had to made a comparison between ITC in their books and ITC in 2A. ITC in 2A would not be populated because no one would have filed their GSTR-1s, including those who are above 5 crores. They would have been unnecessarily put to hardship in such times and would have had to pay tax even in respect of ITC that was otherwise available. To give relief to them and to give relief to all others as well, because when you might be filing your 3B, even within the June period or due dates, which were the month of June, at that time, it is still possible that GSTR might not have been filed by some of the taxpayers or a majority of the taxpayers, since everyone is allowed to file it by 30th of June. Now, if I'm allowed to file GSTR 1 by 30th of June and I have to file 3B earlier than that, then I would have paid excess tax, which would have otherwise been available to me as ITC. Government has suspended application of Rule 36 for this time period. During this interim period, government has said that whenever you are filing returns for the months of February, March, April, May, June, July, August. So for returns pertaining to the period, that is tax period February to tax period August, you don't need to make comparison with 2A. Applicability of Rule 36.4 has been suspended for those tax periods. Whatever amount you are taking in your 3B for these return periods need not be compared to 2A, and you can directly refer your books of accounts and take ITC for that period that is there in your books of accounts. Am I clear? Now, what happens thereafter? Up to August, I don't make that comparison. When I come to September, then government has said that I would need to make a comparison on a cumulative basis for all these tax periods. Now, what I mean to say, right from February up to September, whatever entries are appearing in your 2A, please compare those entries with the ITC that you have populated in your returns for tax periods from February to September. And that comparison, once you have made, you will have to decide that whether you are still in terms of the limit prescribed by Rule 36.4 or not. I'll take a simple example to explain this, because it might be possible that you might have not understood this just by the wordings of it. And if my description is not clear, then I would supplement my narration by this example. Please look at this table. Now, when you look at this table, it has returns for various periodicities or various tax periods. I have also given figures under various statements. So I have for February, the ITC figure, which is appearing in JCR 2A, ITC figure, which is appearing in my books of accounts, and the ITC figure that I have claimed as ITC in my 3B. Then I have also drawn a comparison. Now, when I've done this comparison, I have done it on a monthly basis. Okay, so first let me go month by month, and I'll try and explain to you what I actually mean at the end of it, right? February 2020, if you just see, I have said that the ITC that I have in my books of accounts is 120 rupees. ITC that I have in my books of accounts, if I compare to 2A, now this 2A that I'm comparing is in the month of September. Okay, that means that I am now filing my return for tax period for the tax period September 2020, which would be somewhere in October 2020. So 2A, as on say, for example, 20th of October 2020 is what I'm seeing. 2A for 20th of October 2020 or 2A as on 20th of October 2020 displays a figure of 100 rupees pertaining to the return period February. Okay, so now I have ITC in my books, which is 120 rupees. 2A shows that I'm having ITC of only 100 rupees. 3B I filed basis my books of accounts, so I took 120 rupees as ITC. Thereby, if I actually go and compare it with 2A, I am having excess availment of 20 rupees of ITC. 236(4) says that I can exceed my ITC only by 10%. So thereby I could have gone up to 110, but not 120. Okay. For the purpose of this example, we'll assume that the 10% limit is also not there. You are going to take ITC exactly as has been prescribed under GSTR 2A. Okay, or as is reflecting in GSTR 2A. You don't get any limit, right? So if I go for various tax periods and make this comparison, I see that in totality, just refer, please come to that first subtotal column, right? The first total that I have is that I have 935 rupees of ITC in my books of accounts. This 935 rupees of ITC, which is appearing in my books of accounts, is also what I have taken in my 3B. So I have claimed all this entire ITC that is appearing in my books of accounts in my GSTR 3B as well. After having taken this ITC in 3B, if I actually go and make this comparison with 2A, because I might have not made this comparison on month-on-month basis between February to August, but government is saying that when you come to file your return for tax period September, at that time, please make a comparison, right? So for August, my ITC was 930 up to August rather, from February to August, my ITC was 935. I have taken also 935. 2A shows a figure of 830. I have ignored that figure and yet taken 935. Now come to the month of September. So somewhere in October, when I'm preparing my September's return, I make this comparison. I realize that there is a difference between my 2A figure and my books figure. Since figure as per books exceeding ITC in 2A by 105 rupees, what has happened is I will have to make adjustment for this excess ITC that I have availed. Now what I do is I also check my 2A for the month of September. 2A up to September shows that I have total ITC of 950 rupees. When I have total ITC of 950 rupees in 2A, I will need to ensure that my 3B from February to September also shows a cumulative ITC of 950 rupees only, right? I had already availed 935 rupees of ITC in August. I can avail in September maximum cumulative ITC of 950 rupees. So, jo mera difference hai, 950 or 935 is 15 rupees, right? This is the balance ITC that I can avail in September to be compliant with rule 36(4). Agar rule 36(4) ka compliance karna hai aapko September month ke return mein, to aapko ensure karna padega ki aapka 3B ke jo total hai from February to September, wo aapke 2A ke totals ke sath match ho jaye for the same period. In that pursuit, get to claim another 15 rupees of ITC. Right now, automatically, when I do this 105 rupees of ITC that I had available extra as per books, somewhere adjusted now, right, in this process. Coming to, okay, so now I think we have understood what this rule says and how you will comply with it. What are the challenges that we could face? GSTR 3B, when you file for the month of September 2020, it's going to be a very critical month when you file your GSTR 3B, when you are in October filing for September. I'll tell you various reasons why you will have to be careful. First reason is that the 6 months criteria for debit note, credit notes, etc., that would have been expiring, right? Any additions or alterations to my invoices that I'm required to do would also be the that time that is the end time to do those alterations, right? Post this September's return, I'll not be able to do those alterations. Again, ITC that you've availed is spread over two financial years. So working would also be, and your books would also be spread over two financial years, and you will have to make a comparison over two financial years, giving regard to the fact that the last financial year, the preceding financial year, 19-20, is coming to a close in terms of your GSTR 3B filings. You will not be allowed to make any subsequent adjustments for any omissions, errors, etc. that you made during the returns for the period 1920. Right? So thereby, this would be a very critical period, and you will have to check thoroughly through several things that whatever adjustments you are doing is not simply basis your 2A for February to August 2020, but a comprehensive check for the last financial year as well as whatever you've done during the current financial year, which is ongoing. I hope I have made this clear in terms of compliance as well as in terms of difficulties that some of us might experience. Now, I come on to, after having completed the provisions relating to the normal taxpayers, I come on to the provisions, as I said, for composition dealers. They have also been given respite, and they have also been allowed to file returns within extended timelines to be given concessions in terms of late fees or interest. First concession that they have been given is obviously in terms of return filing. I can file my return in a belated manner and yet not pay any interest or late fees. Second concession that I have been given is for the next financial year, that is the financial year which we are already into, from April 2020 to March 2021. Right? This financial year, I had to opt for composition scheme by filling a form. That form, whether I have filled it until now or not, does not make a difference. Ideally, the due date would have been the end of the month. But even if I have not filled it by that date, I have been given an extended timeline of 30th of June to fill that form and opt for composition for the period 2020. So any person wanting to opt for composition can do it right up to 30th of June 2020. Obviously, you should have not filed your returns under the normal or regular taxpayer. Otherwise, you will be not entitled to this concession. Further, I need to, if I'm opting for composition, I need to give a statement of my stock as on 31st March 2020, which is there in ITC 03 form. This ITC 03 form can also be filed in a belated manner without any late fees, etc. I can file this form by 31st of July 2020 and make any ITC reversal that I'm required to due to for composition by 31st of July 2020 without any interest. Also, as I said, certain category of taxpayers, composition taxpayers who are required to file GST R4 can file it by the 7th of July. Now, coming on to the next notification, which is a blanket concession that the government has given because they could not have thought and envisaged about all the probabilities and possibilities. Notification gives general concession in terms of timelines to be followed or compliances to be done. This notification not only gives concessions to the taxpayers, but also gives concession to the authorities. The notification says that if there is any date which is falling between 20th of March to 30th of June, all these dates stand extended and I can make compliance for anything that was supposed to be done during these timelines by the 30th of June 2020. So if I have not been able to comply with something which fell between March and June 2020, in that case, government is saying no harm, whether it is the taxpayer or whether it is the authority, both have the right and both get an extended timeline to comply with provisions and do it by the 30th of June. From the authority's perspective, they can complete any proceeding and pass any order or issue any notice, intimation, notification, sanction, or approval. So it's not only just in terms of proceedings that are on, but also say, for example, if any refunds for the last financial year were getting time barred, then in that case, those have also been extended beyond the financial year that has gone by, and you can file it by 30th of June. An authority can also sanction and approve it by the 30th of June 2020. Even in respect of taxpayers, they can file any appeal, reply, applications, any returns like ISD, TDS, etc. by this extended timeline, and no penal charges, consequences would be imposed on them. However, please note, this extension in terms of timelines or provisions would not be applicable to certain cases, and this includes your date of raising of an invoice. So ideally, you are supposed to raise an invoice within 30 days. You are, or by the time you leave your premises, whatever the case may be, no extension has been granted in terms of invoicing provisions. You are still required to comply with whatever has been stated under the law. Also, any search, seizure, arrest related provisions, they have not been put to rest on account of the current scenario. Notification also mentions e-way bill under this particular sentence, but it also goes on further and says in another sentence that all those e-way bills which were ideally expiring between 20th of March to 5th of April, all these e-way bills will have extended validity and they shall expire on 30th of April 2020. I hope that is clear. So all e-way bills have been granted validity up to 30th of April if they were expiring between 20th of March to 15th of April. So with this, I have completed the first set of notifications, which were the bunch of notifications pertaining to the liberalization on account of compliances with the current scenario in mind. Apart from these notifications were more or less all of them were issued on the 3rd of the current month, 3rd of April. However, during the month of March, there were many notifications and circulars issued. I have also tried to cover in my presentation those particular circulars or notifications. Again, there are many such notification circulars which have been issued during the month of March, especially from 16th March onwards. So those from 16th March to 31st of March is what I've taken in my presentation, and we'll just now, once I start with these notifications, let me tell you, they might be appearing more in terms of numbers, but essentially, hardly four would be really, you know, ones that were extensive consideration or deliberation. Apart from those, most other notifications are relating to some of the other procedural requirements. Many of them, at least 5 to 6 of them, are relating to Jammu and Kashmir. Since Jammu and Kashmir has been notified as a separate, now they have, well, after the abolition of Article 370, they have been notified as a separate union territory, etc. They have statehood and they have come into the purview of the larger definition of India, etc. They had been given extensions during that period when Article 370 was abolished. Those timelines were falling within the current timelines, which coincided with the lockdown. So again, extensions have been given to them for all categories of taxpayers registered in JNK to comply with those timelines that expired in March by June or July. I'm not going through the notifications, although in my list you will see those notifications, but basically we'll try and cover certain other important notifications which we need to deliberate upon. Starting with the list of notifications, first is 11/2020. This 11/2020 notification is a specific notification brought out as a result of insolvency and bankruptcy code and to cover scenarios under the IBC, right? So those entities who are undergoing the insolvency process, for those entities, this notification is relevant, and maybe all other persons, stakeholders who are again connected to these entities. Next notification is notification 12/2020. This notification is for composition taxpayers, and again it has given a certain respite to composition taxpayers who could not comply with certain provisions because the government had not been able to bring out the forms that were necessary, and thereby, since they were not able to comply with those forms which the government failed to deploy, they had as a result filed form 3B, etc. Now, ideally, had they filed CMP 0A, so those service category of taxpayers who could have opted for composition scheme, they were required to file CMP 0A. Government could not deploy it for those category of taxpayers. They ended up paying their taxes through 3B. Consequently, they would also be required to file GSTR 1. But being under composition, they should ideally not file GSTR 1, and thereby the government has given them the relaxation from filing GSTR 1 through notification 12 by 2020. Notification 13 by 2020 is notification again. Maybe you can say to consider the current scenario, the difficult times, and maybe also a little more time has been given for preparation to the trade as well as to the revenue. And thereby the government has delayed the provisions relating to e-invoicing and QR code related invoicing requirements. So 13 is basically for that kind of compliances that we had to do in terms of e-invoicing or QR code related requirement that was supposed to be done on your invoicing. They have all been deferred right up to October. So we need not bother about them till 1st of October. Next is 15 by 2020. 15 by 2020 is the notification wherein the annual return, which was ideally becoming due on the 31st of March, has been deferred up to 30th of June 2020. So your GSTR 9, 9C both have been deferred up to 30th of June 2020. 16 by 2020 is an important notification, and it has amended various CGST rules, various rules under CGST. And thereby, we will get into that notification in detail when we come to the relevant slide. Next notification is set of notifications on Aadhaar related authentication. 17, 18, 19, these three notifications are relating to Aadhaar related authentication when a person is obtaining a new registration, right? So whenever now I will apply for a registration post 1st of April, I will need to authenticate my details and match them with the details in UIDAI system. Next is 20 by 2020. As I said now, right from 20 by 2020 up to 26 by 2020, right? So those seven notifications are for Jammu and Kashmir, and this JNK related notification take up because they are basically extending all the due dates which were for taxpayers registered in JNK and due dates falling due within the month of March, they have all been extended now up to June or July, as the case may be. Next notification is 27 by 2020. This notification is seeking to prescribe timelines for filing your GSTR 1, right? For again, one category of taxpayers. 28 by 2020 is again due date for filing GSTR 1 for another set of category of taxpayers. Again, because we have new notifications 3rd of April, which have given relaxations, these wouldn't assume too much significance except for the due dates that we are required to pay attention to. And 29 by 2020 prescribes a due date for 3B. So earlier to prescribe the due date for GSTR 1, 3B due date is prescribed by 29 by 2020, correct? So only if you don't comply with those concession notifications, these notifications will come into relevance or consideration. Now, as I said, there were three or four notifications, 16, 17, 18, 19. These three notifications are basically relating to Aadhaar authentication. This new system, this new procedural compliance has been made mandatory, as I said, from 1st of April 2020. Any person or all those people who are taking registration on and after 1st of April will now have to submit their Aadhaar related details, and which would be matched at the back end with the UIDAI system. Government has said that this Aadhaar verification is a mandatory provision. How they have made it mandatory and what will happen is something I'll give you insight into. What happens is that if you have applied for a registration, the form will ask you for your Aadhaar details. These Aadhaar details are required in respect of any proprietor, any person who is an authorized signatory in the application, any person who is a managing partner in the firm, or an authorized partner to sign the GST related compliances or forms or refunds or whatever, and also a karta of an HUF. So all these category of taxpayers or all these set of taxpayers or persons in respect of taxpayers or representing the taxpayer are required to submit their Aadhaar details also. The government will match the Aadhaar details. You also have the option of saying that I don't have an Aadhaar and thereby I want alternate means of compliance. government will give you alternate means of compliance. However, if the government is giving you alternate means of compliance, the government will not process your registration until there has been a physical verification of your application by visiting your premises. So the new change in registration provisions that comes into effect from April is that if your Aadhaar details don't match, your registration is not approved. Your registration will only be after a visit by the officer to your premises. The officer shall visit your premises within 60 days. In that period of 60 days, whenever he visits your premises, the person whose Aadhaar details have not been captured by the system is required to be physically present at that premise and meet the officer. Officer will get you to fill the certain documents and will take the photo of the premises. These details that the officer captured during the physical verification will be uploaded within 15 days of his visit onto the GST portal, which will also be visible to the taxpayer. Only after the physical verification is completed will your registration get processed. So no registration if Aadhaar details don't get matched and a physical verification has not happened, is what I simply want to say. Also, this particular provision is not applicable to certain class of people. Now, the language, if you look at it, is a very funny language, and probably, you know, it's a bit difficult to understand that language. I'll just take you through that notification so that you don't get confused if at all you happen to read that notification. This is a notification which is exempting, or which is saying that certain category of people will not be required to comply with this Aadhaar related authentication. So the government has said that all those people, the central government, on the recommendations of the council, hereby notifies the date of coming into force of this notification as the date from which the I don't think this is that notification. I'll just go on to the website only. Just one moment. So 17 by 2020 is the notification that is basically relevant. It's not displaying on the screen. So anyways, I think I am not able to get an access to that notification to the website. I'll just skip it for the moment. I'll try it towards the end of the presentation. But basically what the notification says is that for all class of persons, except these class of persons, the provisions relating to Aadhaar authentication will not be applicable. Okay. Also, any non-citizen of India will not be required to comply with the provision. So any person who is not a citizen of India would obviously not get an Aadhaar number. Since he does not have an Aadhaar, he cannot use these means as verification related procedure. And thereby, all those people who are not citizens of India, thereby not possessing Aadhaar, are exempted from this procedure. It goes on to say that following class of persons, apart from the below class of persons, are also exempted. So again, basically what they mean to say is that only the below class of people, which I have written as A, B, C, and D in my slide, are the ones who are required to comply. As I said, it essentially covers all those people who are going to be authorized to deal with the officers for the purpose of GST. So individuals, authorized signatory of all types, managing and authorized partners, and Karta of HUF. So practically, virtually, they've covered everyone, right? Except for, say, for example, directors. Say, when you're filling up a form, you're giving up the details of directors who are not going to be authorized signatories. Thereby, they are not required to undergo authentication. After the set of notifications relating to Aadhaar, we come to this notification 16 by 2020, Central Tax Notification. As I said, this notification is one of those single most notifications which is of high relevance and needs deliberation, or which needs explanation. Thereby, I'll just take you through this notification before we move on to any other notification, right? Now, this notification 16 by 2020, as I said, is trying to amend certain CGST rules. The reason why it is trying to amend those rules is on account of the fact that GST Council meeting, which happened in March, had proposed certain changes to those rules. Now, those changes that have happened as a result of GST Council meeting need to be given formal effect. And the government is trying to bring out now those effects or notify those effects which have happened in GST Council meeting. First effect I said, which we have already kind of discussed, is that GSTN 9 date has been extended. Annual return date has been extended. The date for compliance with 9C has also been extended. Not only that, the GST Council meeting had also proposed to extend the criteria of applicability of GSTN 9C to only those people who are above 5 crores in terms of aggregate turnover. Right? So now GSTN 9C is only required to be filed by those category of taxpayers who are above 5 crores. And earlier, this criteria was 2 crores. And thereby, some more taxpayers will not be required to file their reconciliation statement in or audit report in GSTR 9C. So, beneficial provision. Next is amendment to Rule 86, Subrule 4A. This particular rule has been amended because there was some mischief that the authorities noticed was being done by various taxpayers. And some of those taxpayers who were trying to claim undue benefit, the government has tried to correct that particular anomaly. If you would be aware, there are provisions under the Act which say that if I have wrongly paid a tax, I have paid excess tax, then I'm entitled to a refund. Some taxpayers, what they were doing was, they were intentionally paying excess tax. It was not an error or an omission. It was an intentional act. This intentional act was due to the fact that had they paid their due tax only, then they would have not been entitled to a refund, because the provision gives you refund only if you are exporter or you have an inverted duty structure. For all other taxpayers who have excess balance in ITC, they are not entitled to refund. Now, these taxpayers intentionally reported higher tax amounts and then went to the government for cash refund of those excess amounts paid, thereby liquidating their ITC. Government has now said that if you have paid ITC, which is in excess of, or you have used ITC to pay tax, which was in excess of the requirement, then you can still come for a refund. However, the refund will be recredited to your credit ledger only. It will not be granted to you as a cash refund, thereby trying to suppress this mischief that certain people were trying to create or take advantage of. Obviously, the downside or the issue that I see with this is that genuine taxpayers who are applying for a refund of excess amounts paid, probably post discontinuance of business or post a period after which they don't have too much liability to adjust from the electronic credit ledger, they might suffer, but the rule has been amended and it stands what I have already told you. Next rule that has amended by this notification is rule relating to exports. Again, this rule has caused a lot of havoc. All of probably who are into exports would have already gone and would have realized the havoc that, or the equilibrium that can create. I'll just tell you what the provision says. The provision is that all those exporters who are exporting goods, the definition of turnover of zero-rated supply of goods under the formula used to decide the amount of refund is amended. So when you go to provisions relating to refund, there is a provision relating to refund where you can claim refund if you are an exporter and you are, since making zero rated supply of goods, you are entitled to refund of ITC. That refund of ITC that you are entitled is basis your that you have as compared to your export turnover. So the refund that I get is basically a proportion of my export turnover to the domestic turnover. The government has tried to amend this definition or this formula, and thereby turnover of zero rated supply of goods, as you can see on the last bullet screen, is that value of zero rated supply of goods made during the relevant period. Okay, so value of zero rated supply of goods made during the relevant period without payment of tax under bond or LUT. Sorry, I'll just reread it. Turnover of zero rated supply of goods means the value of zero rated supply of goods made during the relevant period without payment of tax under bond or LUT. So far so good. Here it says zero rated supply of goods ka turnover is that turnover which is in respect of goods supplied during the relevant period under a bond or an LUT. However, the problem starts from this word or, right? So once I read this word or, this is where the problem will now start arising. Or the value which is 1.5 times the value of like goods domestically supplied. The value of like goods domestically supplied by the same or similarly placed supplier as declared by the supplier, whichever is less. So the first part of this or the later after this word or this word or is what I need to compare, right? And after I've compared both of these criterias, whichever is less is what is applicable. Now, how it causes difficulties for exporters? Let me give it to you in terms of simple example. Say, for example, I'm an exporter. For the purpose of manufacturing my goods, I am procuring raw material worth 40 lakh rupees. The raw material worth 40 lakh of rupees, I'm exporting at 60 lakh rupees, right? Now, once I have exported this material, I now need to apply for refund of ITC that I had suffered on the procurements of 40 lakh rupees that I had made from domestic person in the DTS. Now, if I am to assume tax rate of 18%, then some 3,20,000 rupees is what I would have paid as taxes. Say, for example, I paid IGST of 3,20,000 on the procurements worth 40 lakh rupees. Now, on export, I would have not paid a single rupee of tax because it was zero rated. I have now gone and applied for a refund of 3,20,000 rupees. However, the formula would be, even if I'm a 100% exporter, I would have to calculate my refund as export turnover upon total turnover into the ITC for that period. Thereby, my export turnover would be 60 lakh rupees. Total turnover is also 60 lakh rupees. ITC for that period is 3,20,000 as we discussed. I will be entitled to 3,20,000 as per criteria one, which is before the or. Now taking into consideration the second criteria, which is actually what has been amended. What will happen is that now the 40 lakh rupees of procurements they have exported as 60 lakhs. Say for example, instead of 60 lakhs, I export it at a value of 65 lakhs. Am I clear? What I'm trying to say is that I made a procurement of raw materials worth 40 lakh rupees. I paid IGST on raw material of 3,20,000 rupees. After having that raw material to my premises, I manufactured my finished goods and sold them for 65 lakh rupees. Okay. Now, if I'm selling those goods for 65 lakh rupees, my turnover, total turnover in the denominator will be 65 lakh rupees. However, my numerator would be the total turnover exported, which is also 65 lakh rupees. Now, this denominator, which is 65 lakh rupees, the denominator, which is 65 lakh rupees, has to be now also compared with the second criteria, which says that it should also be compared to 0.5 times the value of goods domestically supplied by same or similar supplier. I have not supplied these goods in domestic area. I have only made exports. So there is no value that the officer can ascertain for these goods from my books of accounts, which have been sold locally. However, these raw materials are procured from another supplier. Now, assuming that I did not make any value addition, the material that I procured was worth 40 lakh rupees. It is exactly this raw material only that I have sold for 65 lakh rupees. I have to now substitute the 65 lakh rupees and compare it with 1.5 times the value of goods which I have domestically procured. So 1.5 into 40 lakhs. So that will give me 60 lakhs. Are you getting my point? Now, if I compare this to my first part before the OR, the result would be that 65 lakhs would be compared to 60 lakhs. I hope you have understood. The 60 lakhs that I have arrived at is basically 40 lakhs into 1.5 times. So 40 lakhs into 1.5 times is equal to 60 lakhs. So the second part is 60 lakhs. First part before the OR is 65 lakhs. Lower of the two is 60 lakhs. My formula for export refund now changes to export turnover, which is still 65 lakhs, upon total turnover in respect of zero rated supply of goods, which is 60 lakhs, being lower of 65 or 60 lakhs, into 3,20,000. Thereby, I will not be entitled to full ITC and I cannot claim full ITC. Okay, so turnover of zero rated supply will be now lesser. It will be 60 upon 65 into 3,20,000. And thereby entire 3,20,000 would not be available to me as a refund, despite me being an 100% export oriented unit or a 100% exporter. Right. So again, I hope we are clear with this. This rule has been changed. If I'm to give you the intention to change the rule was, there were certain category of exporters who were trying to obtain a higher refund by manipulating their export price and trying to jack up their export price, export value, and thereby claim more refund of ITC. In order to suppress such practices, the government made this amendment. But in this process, genuine exporters will also suffer. And I'm sure this particular provision will be challenged at various before the courts, etc. And mostly, there would be a lot of litigation and we might have to see how it progresses. Coming on to the next provision, which has been amended, again, this is a procedural amendment. Here, the government has again tried to say that when you have filed a refund, that refund can be credited either to your electronic credit ledger or be given to you as cash in respect of certain things. I'll not get into too much details on account of shortage of time. Next provision, rule number 96B, which has been inserted in the rules. Again, this is relating to exports. Again, this is a recovery mechanism which prescribed in respect of those cases of exports where my realization proceeds have not been credited into my bank account within that time frame as defined under FEMA. Now, if I'm not able to get my export proceeds realized, then thereby I have to pay back the refund that I have got. And when I am able to realize my export proceeds is when I will have to again apply for a refund. I'll be able to apply for a refund only after I'm able to realize my export proceeds and government will sanction that refund, right? After this, we have another consequential amendment. Sorry for that difficulty in some technical issues. Basically, this next amendment is also a consequential amendment arising out of that provision for recovery of refund if court process have not been realized. The government has made a change to the declaration in the GST RFD 01 form. And here it is making you promise that if you are not able to realize your export proceeds, you will pay back the refund with interest. Another refund related amendment that has come in is that if the refund is spread over two financial years for a refund claim, earlier there was restriction. There was a restriction in terms of my refund application. I could not spread it over two financial years. Exporters are facing difficulties because there were procurements in the month of March. Those procurements were used to manufacture goods which were exported in the month of April. Because of this, the refund was spread across two financial years. We were not able to claim this refund. The government considered this difficulty and has now removed the provision and thereby has allowed claiming of refund over two financial years as well. Another amendment that the government has tried to do in order to suppress the mischief is that what was happening is that at times the government used to come out with a lower rate of tax in respect of certain commodities. So say for example, a commodity which was attracting 18% GST has now gone down to 12% GST rate. People started applying for refunds on account of inverted tax structure in such cases, and the balance in ITC was sought as refund. The government has clarified by virtue of this circular that you cannot be making refund claims on account of inverted rate structures if your input and output is the same product and the only thing that has happened is a rate change has happened on the product due to a notification. Next amendment is again relating to refunds. This amendment says that authorities have gone to the government requesting them that any amount that is not reflecting in GSTR 2A should not be allowed as refund to the taxpayer. Earlier, the government had said that if you have amounts, if you have invoices which are not reflecting in GSTR 2A, you can still apply for a refund. That refund you can apply by submitting self-certified copies of the vendor invoices and the officer will process that refund. It is only your duty to ensure that eventually those invoices get reflected in your GSTR 2A, else the government can make recovery of the excess amount. However, with this amendment, you will not be entitled to apply for refund in respect of any invoice that is not appearing in your 2A. Further, when you file a refund application, you have to give a working of the vendor invoices in respect of which you are claiming a refund. Table format was given by the government. That table was in Annexure B. That Annexure B which you submit to supplement your refund working has also undergone a change. Now you have to add one more column to that Annexure B, which is basically in relation to your HSN codes. Am I clear? So now HSN or SSC code would need to be mentioned in your Annexure B. Coming on to the next slide, I already covered this, that your turnover of exports would now be compared with 1.5 times of domestic supplies and whichever is lower is what will be taken for the purpose of your refund application calculation. ...96B recovery of refund on unutilized credit. I'll not get into too much detail on account of shortage of time. I've already covered it in essence when I covered that recovery of the refund on account of non-realization of export proceeds. I'll now come on to the notification in relation to insolvency and bankruptcy code that has been issued. The notification in relation to insolvency and bankruptcy code deals with, as I said, those entities which are undergoing the CIRP the corporate insolvency resolution process. Those entities which are falling under the insolvency bankruptcy code undergoing the CIRP process are now deemed distinct persons. The notification says that these entities will be deemed to be distinct persons, thereby meaning to say that they will have to take a fresh registration even if they had registration earlier, and those registrations which they had earlier would only be limited to their affairs which pertain to pre-CIRP process, that means pre-insolvency commencement date. After insolvency proceedings have commenced, those all affairs would need to be reported under this new GST registration that you would take. This new GST registration, you would have to apply within 30 days from commencement of insolvency proceedings or within 30 days from this notification if your insolvency process has already commenced. So there could be some entities which have already been undergoing the CIRP process. All those entities which are already undergoing the CIRP process, they had obviously no knowledge of this notification since it was not in existence. Thereby, government has said that if you have not taken a registration until now, but insolvency proceedings have already commenced, then the resolution professional is now required to make an application within 30 days from the issue of notification. The question came before the CBIC that whether the old registration should be cancelled since you have taken a new registration now. Obviously, since your business affairs have not discontinued as such, I mean, your entity has not gotten discontinued, it's only a break in your business affairs. Again, your business affairs might have still continued because under the IBC law, you are required to continue as a going concern, and RP has to make first all best efforts to ensure that the entity can continue as a going concern, only post which he can seek liquidation. So thereby the government has said that earlier registration need not be cancelled or should not be cancelled. At the most, if there are no business affairs which are being continued now, that registration can be suspended for the time being by the officer. However, it shall not stand cancelled. As I said, all new affairs post insolvency will be reported under the new registration. This another question that came up was, is the resolution professional required to file returns of the old GST number which were pending? Answer is again no. It is not the duty of resolution professional to file the old returns. He only has to ensure compliance in respect of the new registration that he has taken. Next issue that comes up is whether the new registration that you have taken can capture the old details that have happened before the notification came into force. So as I said, your insolvency proceeding, say for example, might have commenced in December, notification came into effect in March, and thereby your registration would only be done in March or April. So what about the period from December to March or April? How do you capture affairs during this period? Answer to that is that government has said that after you take the new registration, you are supposed to file your first return. A first return will be filed which will capture the details right from the date of commencement of insolvency proceedings right up to the date of application of registration. And after that, you will follow your normal return filing process of GSTR1 and GSTR3B. Similarly, for credits, it would suffice if you have taken that credit under the old GST number. What they mean to say is that since your liability is now being reported under the GST number which you have just taken, my December to March turnover is under the new GST number. If my ITC for December to March is not appearing in the new GST number, I would have to make excess tax payment and thereby put to undue hardship. Thereby, the government said that even the ITC for December to March can be taken in the new GST number. However, they are not suspending the comparison provisions under 16.4 or 36.4. The rule 36.4 provisions are applicable. But if these are appearing in your GSTR 2A of the old registration number, then also it would be fine and the officer would be required to give you credit despite they not appearing in your GSTR 2A for the new number that you've taken. Practically how officers will give credit or whether they will deny on the ground level need to be seen. I see an issue there, but as far as the provision is concerned, I think there is no issue. So with this, I have completed insolvency related provisions as well. I will just throw light on certain announcements that were made in the council meeting for which we are still awaiting notifications. One of the most important announcements was in relation to interest liability. As you are all aware, interest liability was being calculated on gross basis by the government. When I say gross basis, the departmental officers were not considering the ITC that was used to pay the tax. So say for example, my return was due on the 20th of March. I ended up filing it late on the 25th of March. Since my 3B got delayed by 5 days, I have to pay interest. Question was before the officer was whether interest should be calculated on gross basis. When I say gross basis, if I have liability of 20 lakhs, I have also 15 lakhs of ITC and cash payment that I'm supposed to make is only 5 lakhs. So whether the entire GST of 20 lakhs would attract interest or whether the GST would attract interest to the extent of only 5 lakhs. Answer to this, the council has given. They have said we are making retrospective amendment. You will not be required to make interest payment on the gross amount, which is 20 lakhs. ITC, since it was already available with the government, you should not be put to hardship and thereby only the cash payment, excess cash payment is what should be attracting interest. However, notification of this has not come out. In the past also, there has been some flip-flop on this issue. If you are aware of this, you would be aware how we are still awaiting clarification on this interest issue. Liabilities on account of this have already been worked out and sent to various taxpayers by the officers. Credits have also been blocked on account of non-payment of this. And thereby, we are really expecting some relief to come in terms of notifying these provisions, although it is already standing in the books. I think apart from this, majorly I have covered all the changes that have happened in the recent times. There is one change in relation to capital goods, ITC on capital goods. When I say capital goods, there has been some change in the rule relating to availment of ITC on capital goods, and that availment of ITC on capital goods has now undergone a change. If you are using those capital goods for making exempted and taxable both supplies, problem which happens, which you are all aware, is that when making a exempt supply as well as taxable supply, I need to make proportionate reversal. The provision was that when I'm availing the ITC on capital goods, which are used to make both taxable and exempt supplies, I used to take net credit. Okay, so say for example, I was using my capital goods only to make taxable supplies. Now, from January to March, I did not make a single rupee of exempt supplies. From April, I started making exempt supplies as well. Now, come April, I will have to make reversal of ITC on capital goods. How that ITC reversal used to happen earlier was, I was given a useful life of the capital asset, which was 5 years under the GST law, as you might be aware. Thereby, I was told that my depreciation rate asset is 5% per quarter, which is 20% per annum. My capital asset would be written off over the entire life under the GST law. I am only specifically talking about the GST law. Thereby, for each month of usage, my ITC to the extent of 5% is utilized. From January to March, I could have utilized the entire ITC that was appearing in my invoice on procurement of capital goods. From April, whatever ITC is there, I will now need to calculate the balance ITC. So 15% ITC has already been utilized, the balance 85% of ITC will now attract reversal. Earlier, I used to take the net effect of this reversal, meaning to say that I used to take 85 rupees, multiply it by my ratio of exempt turnover to total turnover, and reverse of the amount. However, now the government has said that what you need to do is, in your 3P, report the gross amount of capital goods, ITC gross that you've taken on the capital goods. So I will report 85 rupees in my outward liability. The balance ITC that I am still entitled to avail, I can avail it as ITC in my ITC related column of 3B. And thereby, reversal would now happen on the gross amount, which is 85 rupees. So my ratio of exempt turnover to total turnover is now being applied on 85 rupees instead of the net amount that I used to calculate earlier. Thereby, this would attract a little more a reversal as compared to the erstwhile provision. In the absence of time, I might not be able to get into too much deliberation of this, but I hope I have been able to throw some light on this. With this, I would conclude my session for today, and I will be very thankful. I am thankful for you for a very patient hearing. I hope you are now somewhat abreast with this whole set of notifications that have come out in recent times. Thank you so much.
Thank you, CA Ashish Kedia, for explaining the various notification issued to provide relief to taxpayers in view of the COVID-19. He explained the relief for the various projects leading to ITC of capital also, and the various other provisions with the help of examples. I thank you again for Ashish Kedia and CA Ashish Kedia for explaining the notification and the use of the law. Thank you. And we conclude this session for the session. Thank you.
Thank you.